All right. Is there some event going on in the university? There's a career fair going on? Oh, okay. Okay. Or maybe people are doing assignment, I don't know. Okay, so let's talk about, so we have studied projection theorem, we have studied projection onto different types of convex sets. What we have learned in the previous class is, okay, if there are certain sets, projections are easy. If the set is a slightly more complicated, then the projection becomes a horrible optimization problem to solve. And so in some cases, projection may not make any sense. So now, today, we are going to go into the algorithmic foundations for computing constrained optimization problems over convex sets. So the goal is, I want to minimize fx, where x is in capital X. Capital X is a subset of Rn. It's closed and convex. The gradient descent algorithm, as usual, follows the same approach. Xk plus 1 equals to xk plus alpha k dk. Dk is the descent direction. And given the fact that this dk is a descent direction within the convex set, it must be in the set of feasible directions. So it must be in D of xk, which means dk should be of the form x bar k minus xk, where x bar k is in capital X. So if I pick my dk, which is some point in the set, minus the current point that I'm standing at the moment, then I'm going to get a feasible direction where I can take a step. And naturally, alpha k has to be picked in an appropriate fashion so that you're not going outside the set. So the question now is, how do you pick descent direction dk, and how do you pick the step size alpha k? So let's defer the discussion about dk for the time being, because in order to compute dk, I need to compute x bar k. And at this point of time, I don't want to talk about how to compute x bar k. We'll talk about it in 10 minutes. Let's just focus on the fact that dk is given to us. Somebody gave us dk, the descent direction. I just have to pick alpha k. So how do we pick alpha k? So the first method for picking alpha k is the limited minimization rule. Where you pick alpha k equals to argmin alpha in 0, c f of xk plus alpha dk. So that's the limited minimization rule. Typically, C would be equal to 1. The second approach for computing alpha k could be Armijo's rule, which you're all now familiar with because you have applied it in some situations. for some problems in MATLAB. So you could pick limited minimization rule, you could pick Armijo's rule, and you could pick constant step size. Where alpha k is equal to 1 for all k. You are, of course, free to pick any value of alpha k less than 1 as well in under the constant step size. But of course, in all these situations, alpha k cannot be greater than 1. Because if you pick your alpha k greater than 1, you might step out of the constraint set. So it's always important that you check that the step size be less than or equal to 1, but not greater than 1 when you are applying any of the optimization algorithms for minimizing a function over a closed convex set. Okay, so picking alpha k is not that difficult, and you have seen instances of all these three types of rules, and you have implemented Armijo's rule, you have implemented constant step size, and minimization rule, but you haven't implemented limited minimization rule. So we used minimization rule in the conjugate gradient method that you have implemented in assignment 2. That's due today. Armijo's rule, which is also implemented in one of the assignments, and then constant step sizes. I don't know whether you have used constant step size or not, but it's not that difficult. Now we have to discuss the main problem, which is how do you pick dk, or in other words, how do you pick x bar k for solving your optimization problem? Okay. The first algorithm is conditional gradient method. Which is also known as Frank-Wolf method. And the idea here is I'm going to pick my x bar k equals to argmin x in capital X gradient of fxk transpose x minus xk. Okay, so I'm standing at this point, this is my xk, and I'm looking at a gradient of fxk. So I have to pick a direction, x minus xk, so that this inner product is minimized. Okay, the inner product between the gradient and x minus xk is minimized. So by looking at this figure, where do you think should I descend? So I have so many feasible directions. So remember, this is my dk, right? This is my dk. So I have so many different directions to go to. What do you think should I, which direction should I go to? I have to go to a direction where that gradient transpose x minus xk or dk is minimized. Where should I go? What should I do? Where will the inner product be minimized? Excuse me? 90 degrees. Okay, so the 90 degrees would be probably in this direction, right? So the inner product is zero. Can I reduce the inner product further? Can I make it negative? So if it is greater than 90 degrees, then I can move in that direction. So I think this is what the descent direction should look like, and in fact this would be your x bar k. Okay? So we want to descend in a direction where this inner product is less than zero, strictly less than zero. What happens when the argmin, when the inner product is greater than or equal to zero for all x? So I'm doing this descent stuff, and after descending for a long time, I have come to this point xk, so x let's say 500, and now the gradient of fx is pointing in this direction. And so no matter what I do, which direction I pick, dk, my inner product is always greater than zero. What happens then? What should I do? So when I was here, let's say x100, x100, I knew that I have to go in that direction. I cannot go in this direction, I cannot go in this direction, I have to go in that direction, because the inner product turns out to be negative. And I kept sliding towards this direction, and now I have reached this point, x500, where the inner product appears to be greater than zero for all possible values of x. Then what happens? Should I continue to descend wherever the argument, wherever argument takes me? Yes, please.
No, you satisfy the necessary conditions for being able to.
Great, yes. So when this inner product is greater than or equal to zero, you are actually satisfying the necessary condition for optimality. You are at a stationary point, and the algorithm exits. Algorithm says, look, you are at the stationary point. Now it's your problem to figure out whether it's optimal or not. Okay? So once you reach here, basically you stop when gradient of fxk transpose x bar k minus xk is greater than or equal to zero. Because then that's the stationary point. This means xk is stationary. If you are at a stationary point, you don't have to run your gradient descent method again. There is one problem with this conditional gradient method. So when does this method works very well? When you have extremely large number of constraints, or when your surface, it has some curvature. Okay, so these surfaces don't have curvature. You have like five lines, and your x is enclosed between five lines. So it doesn't really have, if you look at the edges, it doesn't really have a curvature. But let me add a curvature. In the convex set, and so you want to run conditional gradient method when you have curvature like this, or when you have too many constraints that looks like this. Your x looks like this, so it has so many constraints that you almost look, it looks like a curved surface. So in those conditions, conditional gradient method does very well. But if you don't have too many curvature, if your constraint set looks like this, then we have a problem. And let me tell you what the problem is. Suppose the optimal solution is here. This is your x star. Okay, and you are inside the set xk. And when you look at the gradient may be, I'm going to draw a line. So this side, the gradient is in this direction. If you are on this side, the gradient is in general in that direction. No. Here the gradient is in this direction. So if you do the gradient descent step, you come here, xk plus 1. Here the gradient is in this direction. So you go here, and then you go here, and then you go here. And so you basically have a lot of zigzag motion, and that's because your x bar k, this would be your x bar k plus 1, this would be your x bar k. And so in the absence of curvature, your x bar would be either this edge, sorry, this vertex or this vertex. And you will keep jumping from one vertex to another, and you will have a lot of zigzag motion in your conditional gradient method, in which case it won't really converge very fast. It will take a long time to converge, and it will require a lot of step size selection rules so as to make it converge to this point x star. So in short, conditional gradient method works very well when you have like a curved edges, but it doesn't really work very well when you have like straight edges and very few number of edges. Then it creates a problem. So if you have some optimization problem with, let's say, 4 or 5 constraints, some very nonlinear function with 4 or 5 constraints, you don't want to use conditional gradient method. But when you have optimization problem with like 500 constraints, you want to use conditional gradient method. It makes more sense in that situation. Okay. Let's talk about the second method. Any question on this before I go to the next method? So next method is gradient projection method. So this is where we use projection, gradient projection method. You do a gradient descent, take the projection, you get x bar k. And then you run one step of the gradient method, of the usual optimization method. Xk minus sk, sk is a step size. Alpha k is also a step size. So we have two step sizes here. Yes, please. Well, this is the projection. Remember, the projection was z plus equals to argmin z minus x, xn capital X. So that's just the projection the projection notation. Okay. So now there are two things. So projection, all of us are familiar with. So all of us know that if I have xk I have to pick some sk, I have to take the gradient descent step, I'm going to step out of the set, possibly. If I step out of the set, then I have to do the projection. Now we have studied projections onto some sets are easy to do, and on some sets it's sort of difficult to do. So, but anyways, the projection can be done under some situations. So now the only thing we need to discuss is how do we pick alpha k and how do we pick sk? Okay, those are the things we need to understand. So let's talk about that. So number one, limited minimization rule. Sk is equal to S, which is a constant. Alpha k equals to, picked according to the limited minimization rule, which we just talked about a few moments back. The second is Ermihoff's rule along feasible direction. Sk is constant, alpha k is picked according to Ermihoff's rule. The third is constant step size, which we all know what that means. Sk is constant and Ak is constant. The fourth one is diminishing step size. Alpha k is constant or maybe equal to 1. You can pick alpha k equals 1. And then sk is greater than, strictly greater than 0, summation sk infinity, summation sk square is less than infinity. So possible options are sk equals to c1 over c2 plus k, C1 over k raised to 0.5 plus delta. Okay, where delta is greater than 0. Okay, so these are the usual, I mean, there is another method that I'm going to talk about now that requires a little bit of thought. Any questions on these methods? I think they are all, yes, please.
Can you just choose C1 and C2?
C1 and C2 are any positive numbers. Like in your assignment 2, problem number 2, I had asked you to pick C1 and C2 appropriately so that it converges. I think in that case, this was gamma over k plus 1, right? Where gamma is something that you need to pick. So it's the same form. Any other question? Okay, so all of these seems very normal. There is no surprise. We have used Ermihoff's rule for picking alpha k here, but your sk still remains a constant. So let's try and understand what happens when instead of picking alpha k according to Armijo's rule, what happens when we pick sk according to Armijo's rule, and then pick alpha k equals to 1 or some constant value. So that algorithm where sk is picked according to Armijo's rule is called Armijo's rule along the projection arc. So that's the fifth method that I want to talk about today. So the fifth method is Armijo's rule along the projection arc. Projection arc. So here, SK is picked according to Armijo's rule. And alpha k is constant, potentially 1. You could pick alpha k equals to 1. So let's think about what this means. So I have a convex set that looks like this, and I'm standing at xk, and I have a gradient of fxk. Now this one is saying that I have to pick x bar k by taking a gradient step in the negative gradient direction with the step size sk, and then take a projection. So I have to go back, go in this direction, and then I have to project it back to the set. This would be my x bar k, right? Now I want to use Armijo's rule here, which means I want to look at, so this is my xk minus sk gradient of fxk. So I want to pick the value of sk according to Armijo's rule so that I get the difference between the function value here and the function value here is sort of reasonably high. Only then I'm going to take that step. So that's the idea of Armijo's rule along projection arc. If this difference is too small, I'm going to reduce my step size, and I'm going to pick this as x bar k. If the difference is too small, I'm going to pick a much smaller x bar sk, and then I'm going to pick this as my x bar k. Okay? So that's the idea in Armijo's rule along the projection arc. So this is the arc. This is the arc, or projection arc. And I'm going to take steps along this projection arc. So in particular, let us define xks as the projection of xk minus s gradient of fxk. That's my xk of s. Now the idea is to pick my sk according to this fashion. So sk equals to beta raised to mks bar such that
mk is the minimum integer or minimum, integer or minimum positive integer satisfying f of xk minus f of xk beta rem 2. So I pick some x, s bar and sigma according to my favorite numbers, and I pick m equals to 0. I see whether this condition is satisfied or not. If it is satisfied, great, I'll pick that m. Otherwise, if m it doesn't satisfy, then I'm going to increase the value of m by 1 and check whether this condition is satisfied or not. If not, then I'll increase the value of m and check whether this condition is satisfied or not. And then I'll take my step size according to that iteration. Okay, so this is the second method, gradient projection method, where in the second method you have like 5 different ways of picking sk and alpha k. What happens when alpha k is equal to 1? What is the value of xk plus 1? When alpha k is equal to 1, it's equal to x bar k. Okay, so whenever you have alpha k equals to 1, basically xk plus 1 is essentially this value. So when alpha k is equal to 1, your xk plus 1 is actually xk minus sk. Okay, so this is the gradient projection method where you take a step, gradient step, project, take another step, project, take another step, project, and so on. That's how it continues. Okay, any question on the gradient projection method? Yes, please. That's right.
What happens?
You actually project for every m.
For every m?
Yeah. So, you know, you remember you have 2 for loops, like an outer for loop and a while loop inside it. So you are actually doing the projection inside the while loop.
Okay.
When you are doing the Arrhenius rule along the projection.
So the distance and the arc, it gets minimized?
Right. So you take a very long step. And if the difference is not satisfied, if this condition is not satisfied, then you shrink it. And then you shrink it further until it starts making sense. Any other question? Yes, please.
Why is there no selection rule where you adaptively choose alpha k and sk? Does it just not make the difference to do that, or is it too expensive?
I think it's too expensive. Yeah, so you either want to pick sk in a nice fashion, or you want to pick alpha k in a nice fashion. You can of course do both, like you can have Arrhenius rule along projection arc and pick alpha k according to Arrhenius rule. It's just going to take a lot of steps. That is not to say that you shouldn't do it. Maybe there is a problem where that makes sense. It's just that people haven't found those problems yet. Maybe you can find something out in some other application. Okay. The third one is the Newton's method. I want to check what the time is. Oh, I have some time. I want to talk about Newton's method. So one thing you should know in optimization, there are multiple things that you can pick and choose. And the goal always is you want to do minimal number of computation to get to the optimal solution. But it's very difficult to know what minimal number of computations mean. Does it mean gradient computation? Does it mean function evaluation? Which one is more time consuming? Which one is less time consuming? So all that trade-off has to be made by the person who's writing the optimization code. And I can guarantee that 10 years from now, all of you will be writing some optimization code somewhere for some embedded system. It could be a optimization for thermostat, it could be optimization for vehicle, it could be optimization for wind farm, but that's exactly what you will be doing for a very long time in your career. Because no matter which direction I look at, people are applying optimization everywhere. So all of you will have to make a lot of trade-offs when you're writing that software for that particular embedded device using a specific microcontroller and using some specific routine, maybe Fortran, maybe C++, maybe C hash or whatever, right? So, yeah. Or you could be writing it on cloud. You could be running some very complicated optimization problem over 20 or 30 processors in the cloud. So you could go anywhere, like you could be on an embedded device or you could be on 20 or 30 or 100 or so servers on the cloud. So yeah, it's a very exciting field at the moment. The third one is Newton's method. So here, x bar k is argmin, x in capital X. Let me write it below. So well, alpha k could be constant, and sk could be 1, or you can, again, you have to pick the right trade-off between alpha k and sk in this optimization problem as well. But this is how you compute x bar k by solving a quadratic minimization problem over the set capital X. So we have been talking about optimization over convex set, but none of you have raised an objection about the fact that we have to solve an optimization problem over convex set. We are trying to come up with algorithms to do that, and the algorithms itself involves optimization over convex set. So how do you do that? Isn't there a circularity in these algorithms where I'm asking you to, you have a big optimization problem, and I'm asking you to solve small optimization problems within that big optimization problem. So it turns out that in many cases, the solution to these problems are not that difficult. Or there are fast algorithms to do this computation. So even though the f itself could be a very complicated function, the gradient of f is appearing as the linear function of x here. So this is, of course, a constant, And so this is a linear function of x, and this is a quadratic function of x. And so what you have is, you are converting a complicated optimization problem into a simpler optimization problem, which is, in this case, a quadratic optimization problem. And hopefully, you can solve the quadratic optimization problem with minimal effort, and you can get x bar k, and then you can do the descent and so on. So it's always the case in optimization that you start with a very complicated optimization problem that is very difficult to solve. So what you have to do is convert that optimization problem into a sequence of optimization problems that needs to be solved, which are much simpler in nature, which can be easily solved within a few milliseconds or a few microseconds or a few seconds. And then you solve it, you take a descent step, and then you go back and recompute what the new optimization problem should be, and you solve it. So it's always a sequence of optimization, sequence of simpler optimization problems that you need to solve to get to the optimal solution. So that's Newton's method. Now in the next class, I'm going to, I still have time. Wow. Any question? I was expecting people will ask me questions. Any other question? Yes.
So far we have all of these methods to calculate x bar.
Right.
In order to calculate dk.
Right. And in order to calculate xk plus 1, right? OK, so now I come to the final topic on this final algorithm for this particular topic, the fourth algorithm, which is manifold suboptimization method. This algorithm, if I'm not mistaken, came up in 1940s. Maybe before that or maybe after that, but it's somewhere in 1940s when this algorithm came out. Can someone tell me why this algorithm came out? So this, I want to solve minimize fx, ax is less than equal to b. So my constraint set is ax less than equal to b. X is in Rn. What happened in 1940s? Anyone remembers?
World War II,
good. So World War II happened in 1940s. Why would people want to optimize? What were people optimizing in 1940s? Sorry?
Flight patterns.
No, not flight patterns.
Resources.
Sorry?
Resources.
So resource allocation problem. I have fuel. I have to send trucks with some shipments on it. How do I send it across like 5 or 10 or 15 different war zones so that in minimum cost I'm able to provide maximum amount of resources to our troops on the ground? So that's why these set of algorithms were determined at that time. Whether it got used or not, I don't know, but that was the motivation, the fact that we wanted to optimally allocate resources among all the troops, and the resources were always constrained. And at that time, linear constraint was a big problem, okay, because they didn't have solvers even for, like, they didn't have access to MATLAB and stuff at that time, right? So they just formulated most of the problems as linearly constrained problems. In some cases, even fx was linear, and they wanted to solve this problem in order to optimally allocate resources. Are you a history buff by any chance? No? Okay, good. But you came with both the right answers. So that's very nice. So that's why people developed the manifold suboptimization method for solving this class of problems. In that time, it was called simplex algorithm. simplex algorithm. And then that was simplex algorithm was devised when fx is actually c transpose x, so it's a linear function of x. And then of course we are studying a more general version of simplex method, which is called manifold suboptimization method, which works for any nonlinear function fx. Okay, so our goal in this particular problem is to, so I, in order to introduce my algorithm, manifold suboptimization algorithm, I have to define some terms. So the first term that I want to define is set of active constraints. Set of active constraints. So let's look at what AX less than equal to B look like. So I have the matrix A, which is A1 transpose, A2 transpose, AM transpose. So each of these A1 transpose is the first row of A, A2 transpose is the second row of A, and so on. And I can write B, B1 to BM. Okay. So all of you understand the structure of the matrices A and B. Number of constraints, that's right. There are m constraints in this particular problem. So I define the set of active constraints A of x as a set of indices I between 1 to m such that AI transpose x equals to BI. So I have five constraints. No, let me make it four constraints. So this is A1 transpose x equals to B1, A2 transpose x equals to B2, so I have four constraints and I'm looking at the region which is inside of this four hyperplanes. Let's consider this point. So let me call this x1. What is the set of active constraints at x1? This area is AX less than equal to B. So at x1, what are the set of active constraints? There's only one constraint that is active, which is A1 transpose x equals to B1. So this is just one. Let's look at x2. So what are the constraints that are active at x2? So x2 actually lies on two hyperplanes, okay, because it's at the intersection of two hyperplanes. So x2 lies both on this hyperplane and it lies on this hyperplane. So both constraints are active. This constraint number one is active and constraint number two is active. So the set of active constraints is 1 and 2 here. Let's consider x3. What are the set of active constraints at x3? So it's not sitting on any of the hyperplanes. So it actually doesn't have any active constraints. So it's a null set. It's a null set. Okay, so there are no active constraints on x3. Okay, and so on. So now you understand or how to visualize what are the set of active constraints at a point. If the point is in the interior, there are no active constraints. If the point is at the boundary or at a vertex, then all the hyperplanes that are meeting at the vertex are the set of active constraints. So what I'm going to do in the next class, I'll ponder over the set of active constraints some more, you know, with different figures. And then I'll talk about the manifold suboptimization method, where what we will do is we will try to apply gradient projection, a simpler version of gradient projection method, in order to solve the problem. So we'll talk about it on Monday. Thank you for your attention. See you on Monday. And I have my office hours right after this, so if you have questions, you can ask me here, or we can just walk to my office and you can ask me questions there.